grade sheet and graded it. And a number of you got pretty good grades that shouldn't have, because a couple of them were, the grader had the grading wrong. The grade sheets. So by just copying and grading it as it was marked, some of you got credit for finding the wrong answer someplace that matched the solution sheet. That's not encouraging for me. So the place where it definitely steps up is on page 29.4. So if you have that, circle it, point two. That's a plus from my perspective, because that means I know that you guys weren't looking at the answer sheet, right? Those of you who had the answer no did have the same answer as the answer sheet, but that's not as encouraging, right? So. You learn the most by actually studying this yourself, all right? It's possible that answer sheets are wrong. I really wish it cost us, because it would have really given me a lot of insight into what's happening and not happening in the class. Okay. The best way to learn is to do these on your own. I think there was another one that had a question. Someone was handing it out. On page 29.3, the electric field there should point from higher potential to lower potential. Mm-hmm. Okay, so the electric field, oh, actually the person who showed that to me, those should be negative voltages, right? On the left, so this is 29.4. So the electric field is increasing. So what does that tell us that the potential is doing? You take the negative integral, so the potentials are decreasing. When we plot the potentials, it'll be negative 20 volts, negative 30 volts. Now, the electric field should be going from left to right, because it's becoming more positive on the left. There was a question about that one also.
How do we determine the size of the lines on that same page with the all right. 6 and 7, just because I got a lot of those lines wrong, or how big they need
to be? So the electric field is the number of volts per meter. Okay. So the electric field
is supposed to be two-dimensional.
It's two-dimensional. If the electric field, if we have a change in 10 volts over 1 meter, what is the electric field? 10 volts per meter. If we change 10 volts over 10 meters, one voltmeter. So the electric field here in the middle is about 10 times the electric field over here. So the closer the lines are, the larger the electric field. It's kind of like if we were walking and we were going down 10 feet here and then another 10 feet from here to here, where is it more steep? It's more steep where you go down 10 feet over a very short distance. Okay. Same way the electric field is stronger when equal potentials are very close. So the question was, how do we find out how the relative size of those field vectors are, or more importantly, how large is the electric field? How close are those equal potential lines?
And what's the difference between like that versus, so that's field line, but
now, these are equal potentials. Let's say 20 volts, 30 volts, 40 volts. Our electric field is going 30 volts, 20 volts, 10 volts. So our potential is going down. So these are equal potentials. Right? So what's the difference between equal potentials and?
Like just the number 9 one that we had on here? I'm just curious. Because like when we would do the, when we had paper in lab and we would spread the, to measure the volt with the voltmeter or whatever it was, mm-hmm. the multimeter. When we take them apart, the further apart they were between the two dots that you would have, the higher the voltage, but then the closer they were, the lower the voltage difference. I was trying to figure out, like, for this one, it was the opposite of what I thought it would be.
Which one are you looking at?
Number 9.
Okay.
It's like the distance there.
So the question is related to this. We have, those are equal potentials, right? These are electric fields. All right. Know about the potential along all those points?
It's the same.
What do we know about the potential along all those points?
It's the same.
So our equal potentials, if this looks like a uniform field, we'd imagine that the potential perpendicular should all be the same. So the potential across all those points is the same, isn't it? We don't know what it is. It might be 10 volts, 20 volts, 100 volts. What about this point compared to this point? The electric field is going in this direction, right? So the potential, are they going up this way? Is the potential going up in that direction or that direction? See, we can imagine there's a positive charge, a positive plate over here, negative plate over here. The potential is going up this way. We can imagine, let's just guess, 0 volts, 1 volt, 2 volts, 4 volts. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So what's, how does the potential from, let's see, let's put these marks, A to B compared to C to D or E to F?
That's true. Right.
What's that? Well, A to B, though, is a decrease, and VAB is negative 2 volts. VCD equals negative, the way I've got it, 3 volts. VEF equals negative 4 volts. So if we rank them in order, biggest, next biggest, next biggest.
Oh, so the difference isn't 4 volts, the difference is negative 4 volts.
Yeah.
That problem asked for the magnitude, though.
Did it say magnitude?
Yeah.
Okay, then order of magnitude, it should be, another error in the, the error answer that got right, according to this paper, was AB is greater than CD is greater than DF. The right answer should be EF is greater than, correct answer, the magnitude here is bigger than the magnitude here is bigger. So the correct answer should be BEF in magnitude is greater than BCD in magnitude is greater than AB in magnitude. So there's apparently a number of problems with these. So if you do have issues with them, please, please mark your issue with it, not correct it. Are there any questions, other questions about it? I kind of actually like this in some sense. I've got your attention like I haven't had your attention in a while. So the upside is you guys are focused on it. And this is not where I wanted to go today, but it's great review. This connection between electric field and potential. What we're doing with circuits really is electricity and magnetism. There are fields that are driving all the phenomena. It's just a little bit nicer way to analyze them. Are there any other questions about the worksheet? Right. So at the end of class, mark what you had not graded correctly. This kind of explains the grades. The grades came in really strange to me when I was keying in. The students who got, I was a little surprised by where the grades were. So some of the perfect grades now, I know that there really shouldn't have been perfect grades. It just meant that somebody found the solution sheet and copied it, which is not a good way to learn. All right. Any other questions? Perfect. What I want to do today is cover a number of topics. One is on the homework. I've extended the homework that we do Monday to today, not because I wanted you to do all but the battery problem on Monday. But I would like to go over what an ideal battery looks like versus an actual real battery. And then I would like to talk about one problem. Lucas?
Does that mean that Wednesday's homework is still due today?
Wednesdays I've pushed off, I think, till tomorrow, and then Fridays I've pushed off to Saturday. Knight talks about lightly, and that is I want to talk about the voltage current characteristic of different devices. So for an ideal battery, I have some voltage across the battery. I have some current that's being delivered by the battery. If I were to graph the voltage, let's call it VO, versus current for this battery, what would it look like? There's zero current out of this battery. What's the voltage of? It's the electric push. You put the voltmeter across it, what's the voltage? Say it's a 10-volt battery. 10 volts. So it's whatever that voltage. If I have 1 amp of current, and I'm coming from the ideal battery, and I measure the voltage across that battery, what's the voltage? Still 10 volts. I have 2 amps coming from that ideal battery. What's the voltage?
Still
10 volts. So an ideal battery, no matter how much current is coming from that battery, the voltage doesn't change. That's what This symbol tells us, this ideal battery, it tells us no matter what current comes from that battery, it's pushing, it has the same electric push.
Does that mean in an ideal battery the resistance somehow changes?
What's that?
Does that mean in an ideal battery the resistance somehow changes?
It means it has no resistance in it. It is just a perfect supply of voltage. There's an electric field in here that if this is a, say, a 10 centimeter battery and it's a 100 volt battery and there's 10 centimeters from the terminals, it means that average electric field is what? 1,000 volts per meter. And that field just never changes.
Does that violate Ohm's law then? Because we have a voltage and we have current.
What does Ohm's law concern? Ohm's law concerns resistors. So if we have an ideal resistor, that is what Ohm's law applies to. So the voltage across the resistor is equal to the current through the resistor times the resistance of that resistor. An ideal battery, and this is pretty cool, right? It could provide an infinite amount of power. There are no real batteries in the world. Let's look at the voltage current characteristic of the battery next, or the resistor next. We have Ohm's law. We now measure the voltage versus the current. If I have a resistor now, let's go ahead and go to the problem.
Do you think you can measure Ohm's law?
What's that?
It's Ohm's law.
That is scary.
R equals one for everything.
If there is zero current through a resistor, what's the voltage through it? Across it? Zero. If I have a 10 ohm resistor and I have 1 amp through it, what's the voltage across it? 1 amp times 10 ohms, 10 volts. There's 2 amps, 20 volts. 3 amps, 30 volts. So the voltage across the resistor is equal to R times I. So it's just a straight line with the slope of the resistance. Does that make sense? Into visualizing what's happening in the circuit. Sometimes this is written as EMF. What does the VI characteristic of this look like? Measured the voltage from this point A to that point B, what would it be equal to?
The voltage across the R.
Say it a louder, Travis?
The voltage of the battery subtracted the voltage across the R.
So Travis said if we go up some voltage VO, the internal EMF or internal voltage of the battery, and then we drop some amount of voltage, the voltage difference across that internal resistance. Well, we could write that algebraically as B A to B V O minus I times R internal. This was a line. What would Y, it's a Y equals V O minus R internal times X, couldn't we? Mm-hmm. What does V O represent? The y-intercept, and minus r be the
slope.
Sure enough, we draw the VI characteristic of an ideal battery. There's no current. The battery's voltage is VO. So if I connect A to B with a perfect conductor, I will get this current out here, where the terminal voltage is now zero. We'll call that I short circuit. Why we symbolize short circuit as SS, I don't know, but they do.
What does short circuit mean? Is that both heard?
Short circuit means you take a perfect conductor and you connect the top of it. If you want to short circuit your car battery, drop a wrench across the terminals. Right. I've done that accidentally while cranking things. It makes a lot of sparks. Right? It's 12 amps times sometimes 300-400 amps. That's a lot of watts. I've heard of electricians, I take my wettering off when I work on a car electrical system. I've heard of people actually burning their fingers off, shorting it with, there's a lot of power in those car batteries. When they rate a car battery, have you ever heard cold cranking power?
Yeah.
They put the battery at a specific temperature, they short circuit the battery, and they measure short circuit current. That is your cold cranking power on your battery.
Knowing that.
When you your motor in the back of your engine, there's a big gear that's connected to your flywheel, and when you start your car, there's a little teeny gear on an electric motor that's got very low resistance. That little little gear on the starter motor, it injects into the flywheel, and that's what starts your car. That motor has almost zero resistance. So that's telling you how much power you can get to that starter motor.
Gotcha.
You notice, what do you know from chemistry? When the warmer a chemical reaction is, the faster it occurs. So in the middle of winter, when your car is really cold, the chemistry inside your battery isn't occurring as fast. It doesn't crank as much current, right? So it's, and the other problem is all the oil in your engine and your transmissions very viscous because it's cold, so it's the hardest time to start your car. All right, so there's a number of different problems with, I could ask about ideal batteries. But just think of it, I'm going to replace the battery with a ideal battery and an internal resistance. You should be able to start using your circuit skills to solve the problem. Any questions about ideal batteries? So inside a circuit with a real battery, you will replace it with an ideal battery and an internal resistance. There's some questions about power. People remember to review power very quickly. rate of change of energy. Probably the most graphic way to describe power is if I take a cool water bottle and I drop it on my toe, all the potential energy quickly gets turned into some kind of other kind of energy when it hits my toe. That's a lot of power because that energy gets changed very quickly. If I slowly pour that water out of my toe, it's a very different experience. But same energy over a lot more time, a lot less power, it doesn't hurt my toe so much. Very graphic way of thinking of power. In an electric circuit, the power is equal to the voltage times the current. So if we think of our car battery, we have some voltage times some current. And if we double the current, we don't change the voltage, we've doubled the power. What about in a resistor? Across the resistor, what do I do to the current?
Pardon me?
Say that one last time.
If I double the voltage across the resistor, what happens to the current?
Quadruple.
It doubles. What happens to the power?
It
quadruples. What if I double the current through a resistor? What happens to the power? It quadruples. What happens to the voltage? Doubles. What if I have a voltage across a certain space and say I have a 120 volt ideal battery, I put a resistor there, there's a certain amount of power. Now I have the resistance. What will happen to the power? I have the resistance, I will double the power. Think through those. Let's see. Let's say I have a circuit. Looks like this. 10 volts. 1 amp. 12 ohms. And I have a black box here. What's the voltage across that box?
Does that say current is equal to 1 amp?
The current here is 1 amp. It's a 12 ohm resistor, 10 volt battery, unknown. Let's call this voltage V unknown. What's our voltage from here to here? 10 volts, positive or negative?
Positive.
And our voltage from here to here? Minus 1 amp times 12 ohms. Then I've defined this as positive to negative, so if we go this direction, is that positive or negative? A drop,
negative.
And minus V unknown, equals zero.
It's
10 volts minus 12 volts minus V unknown equals zero. So this would be, let's see, negative 2 volts equals V unknown. So this is really 2 volts in the other direction. that? It is kind of confusing.
Wouldn't it be negative 2 volts that way? But
so when you're on a switch, the positive.
It's negative 2 volts that way, which is the same as
2 volts or
positive 2 volts in that direction.
Yeah.
So in this case, the black box is a battery.
In this case, it would probably be a battery going the other direction. Could be a battery resistor combination. Any questions about any of this? All right, let's see your clicker. Any questions before we start?
Dr. Simmons told me I can't call them kiddos because yes, I am. They can totally be called. Oh no.
This one's a second. Third floor. Rob. These are parallel capacitors. That's a key phrase here.
Wait, resistors.
Yeah, but you can
resistors?
Draw it so the nuns are true.
Can you? One of these is definitely true. Two resistors in parallel, the combination always has to be less than the smallest resistor. If we have a 2 in parallel with 1,000, it's going to be slightly less than 2. As soon as you add more resistance, you can have the first 2 combined, they're going to be smaller, you combine them the smallest one, and then it's combined with another one. So as long as you're adding resistors in parallel, you're adding additional routes. So if you think about it, you have a voltage across all these resistors, right? There's current going through each one. As you add more resistors, what happens to the current? The current's going up, right? Being delivered by whatever the source is. That means the voltage hasn't changed, the equivalent resistance is changing. We know the current is going up. The voltage that in change, that means equivalent resistance must be going down. It has to be smaller than the smallest resistance.
Yeah. I thought it was like the inverse, though. So
the inverse, what's that?
I thought it was like the inverse, so when you, then you flip it over to get the actual resistance.
Yeah. You can go through all the math and it comes out and it works, but the way to think about it is, you have a voltage from this point to this point. If you add the smallest resistor first, you get some current, right?
Yeah.
Now you add another resistance. Isn't there now more current going to that network of resistors? Collectiveness, right? So if the amount of current is going up, that means the equivalent resistance must be going down. You can go through the math. That's a hard way to do it. The easier way to do it is think about it. Think about the current going to that network of resistors. We have a given voltage across it. As we add more resistors, the current to that network goes up. So that means the equivalent resistance must be going down. Because the voltage, the thought experiment is put the same voltage across the network as the equivalent resistance. And as you build up that network, you have the same voltage across it. As you build up more and more resistors, current increases. If you put resistors in series, you think your thought experiment is I'm going to drive the same current through those resistors. As I build up more and more resistors in series, what happens? The voltage gets bigger and bigger and bigger for the same current. That implies the equivalent resistance is always going up.
So the absolute resistance goes up, but the equivalent resistance goes down.
Now, if they're in series, the equivalent resistance is going up.
Because they all get the same current.
Because they all have the same current and the voltage across them is going up. So think, try to go through the thought experiment and think about that.
So,
all right. All right, that's not bad. It's a hard question. So this is like problem 3269, where we had the diagonal resistors and you had to recognize what they really were. Remember, the parallel elements have the same voltage across them, series elements have the same current through them. It's good to think about these. 3, 2, 1, and all right. If I have this bottom together like this, is that different from this here?
No.
So let's see. In this case, we have a battery and a resistor and a capacitor all in parallel. Does it matter if I put the capacitor here or here?
No.
In which case there's a battery, a resistor, and a capacitor in parallel. In this one we have a battery, a resistor, and a capacitor in parallel. In this one, are they in parallel?
No.
No, the battery and the resistor are series. So A, B, and D are the same. Alright, that's a free one.
Nice.
Answer D, people. Alright, D, 3. There's no someone else. D, 3, 2, 1, done. Everyone deserves that.
You need to check for the guys.
I don't want to know. Alright. So this was kind of like this last thing I did here. If you want to scratch any paper, go ahead. be careful. Is that 8 ohms?
No.
No, that's the voltage across the resistor. So we don't have to multiply. Let's do this together. Let's do Kirchhoff's loop law. We start at the bottom of the battery and go in the direction of the current. We go up 12, right? And let's say it goes. Assume right now that it goes up something. Then what do? We go from plus to minus, that's down 8 volts, down another 8 volts.
6.
Or back to 6 volts. 8 volts minus 6 volts. And we're back to where we started, so the potential difference ought to be 0. So that would imply then that we have 12 volts minus 8 minus 6. That would be plus something minus 2 volts equals 0. What does that mean?
2 volts.
We must have gone up 2 volts. So we must have increased 2 in the direction of I.
How do you know to assume that's positive there?
What's that?
How do you know to assume that's positive?
All right. So if we're going from negative to positive, we're going up. So that's an increase. We call that a positive. If we go from positive to negative, we're going down. That's a decrease.
Yeah, so when you say that's negative, that's...
Oh, let's say I assume that that was a down.
It doesn't even matter.
Right? Let's say I made this mistake. So this, so it's down 2 volts. Is that going to work now?
We can get negative 2.
So that's going to be down a negative 2 volts. So a double negative, that means I've gone up 2. So if I assumed wrong, then what happens is I end up with a negative here. That tells me I assumed the direction wrong.
Okay, yeah, the negative 2 volts.
Okay, negative negative is the same as the positive.
Okay.
That's it. Right. Good question. Now, key for circuit analysis here is when you draw a circuit, I'm going to assume that the current through this resistor is in that direction. I draw the positive and negative sign on that resistor going in the direction, positive and negative, in the direction I've assumed the current. If I get the direction wrong, the current is in the wrong direction and the voltage is in the wrong direction. So I'll get a negative current and a negative voltage. Any questions? All right. I wanted to go over problem 3269, but I need to cover capacitors. If I have capacitors, capacitance tell us? A capacitor in a circuit
we think of capacitors in a circuit as charge storage devices. They store energy by storing charge. That energy is stored in the electric field between the two plates. The capacitance tells us how much charge that device can hold. It tells us how many coulombs we can store for every volt. It's similar to saying in a reservoir, how many acre feet of water can I store for every foot that I fill the reservoir? So in the same way, in a capacitor, I'm saying, how many coulombs of charge can I store per volt of potential? So as I increase the electric field between these two plates so that the voltage increases by a volt, how many coulombs of charge can I hold for every volt? The bigger the capacitor, the more coulombs of charge I can hold per volt. Now what's very interesting is if I have two capacitors in parallel, now, for the same voltage, I can store the same amount of charge in each capacitor. So I can store Q1 over V. This is Q2 over V. So now I'm filling them both up at the same rate. So oddly, parallel capacitors, the C equivalent is equal to C1 plus C2. It's just the opposite of resistors. The way I think about it is I'm taking those two plates and I'm making them bigger. I'm increasing the area by putting them next to each other. Do you want to guess what happens when we put capacitors in series? They act like resistors in parallel. Is as the current comes in, it charges both plates. The voltage across this plate will be equal to Q1 times V1, and the voltage will be Q1 times C1. C equals Q over V. V equals Q over C. And V2 equals Q over C2. When we combine these together, but what you can do is you can show that the combined voltage the charge that we've stored on these divided by the sum of those voltages leads to this relationship. So on our homework we have to find equivalent resistances, and we have to, equivalent capacitances, and we have to find some potential differences. One of the problems looks like this. We have a battery. Attached to a capacitor. There's a switch here. I think it goes like this. This is a battery. C1, C2, C3. And the switch gets moved from over here to over here. So before the switch is moved, what's the charge across on that capacitor?
Is it closed?
Well, start with the switch to the left.
Closed. Okay.
know that the voltage across this capacitor by the loop law has to be V0. So we know then that the capacitance is equal to Q over V, or V equals Q over C. So we know the capacitance, we know the voltage, we know the charge. That's not too bad. Here's what gets tricky. Now we take the switch and we move it over and connect it to there. This charge will redistribute itself between these three capacitors. Current will flow for every coulomb that moves off of this capacitor, a coulomb will flow into this one, and a coulomb will flow into this one. So we have to think how that charge will redistribute itself. We still use Kirchhoff's loop law to find out what those charges will be. We have to have conservation of charge. And I think I'm going to put this off for Friday so we can practice a little. We've run out of time, and I don't think...